Good afternoon and welcome to Piano Fest. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Great. And can I please invite you to turn off your cell phones? That's important also because we are recording the concerts. And we're going to begin our program with the Ravel Sonatine. And I'll invite the pianist on stage and talk about the piece a little bit before you hear it. Gabe? This sonatine, or sonatina, came about because the Paris Critical Review had a competition for a sonatina no longer than 75 measures, a first movement of a sonatina no longer than 75 measures. And Ravel submitted this piece that you're about to hear. The competition was canceled because he was the only contestant, but that's the genesis of this piece. One thing about this piece is it's very different from German music that we hear or other European music. The audiences in France weren't quite as devotedly mystical or idealistic as the German audiences. For France, it was more of an Epicurean taste, something very fine to be savored like good food. And so it's kind of what I would consider a piece with an artificial sound using the pianistic sonorities. It's also different because it uses harmonies and rhythms from a different kind of a scale. We're used to, he uses these intervals. So that creates a kind of more exotic harmony. You'll hear the sounds of bells and percussion instruments. But why don't you begin the piece and we'll hear how it starts. And this is also a piece that is trying not to be as frilly and as coquettish as some other music. It's a little bit more of a, like a Greek revival kind of music. Would you start the minuet? And this could almost be a grandmother's minuet, but just enjoy the very subtle things here. It's a difficult piece to play because it's so delicate, almost like a fine jewel, aristocratic, great taste. Play it. Ravel, in appearance, Ravel was a short man, and he was just as small as a jockey and just as elegant in the way he dressed. Now we hear a completely different composer. When Liszt was in his 70s, he visited a small town in Hungary where he grew up, and he went to the home where he had grown up and was surprised to see the remains of a stove in the kitchen. And he recalled that when he was a boy, he had taken a bag of gunpowder and thrown it in the oven to see what would happen. And of course it exploded and he almost killed himself. But he says that even then it showed that he could attain mass effects. This is based on a scene from Lanau's Faust. Here are the main elements of it. The devil, or Mephistopheles, and Faust are walking, and they come to a village inn. The peasants are dancing, and Mephisto grabs a violin, tunes it, and then plays the violin. And the country folk in the inn become delirious and romantic, and one by one, in couples, they wander off to the woods, and finally, Faust, with one of the ladies in the inn, also goes off into the woods. And towards the end, we hear the nightingale, perhaps at midnight. And you could imagine an orchestra pit. That's how the piece starts, with, after sort of an introduction. Well, I'll invite the pianist to show you. Come, Victoria. Why don't you just start the beginning of the piece, but emphasize when you get to that. So that's how the piece begins. It's a very fast waltz, although I would control it. And show us the waltz itself. Okay. So that's the theme. In the middle of it, we have sort of a seduction scene, a conversation, and why don't you show us maybe. Now the man. Now the woman. And somewhere in the middle of the piece, we hear the devil laughing. Now, in the background of this is Paganini, the greatest violinist of all time. Liszt was so floored by Paganini that he stopped performing for a long time and just studied his composition so that he could emulate what Paganini was able to do on the violin, on the piano. And here you can feel the pizzicato violin technique in the right hand, wherever it's good for you. Mm-hmm. Without pedal, would you play just briefly? That's the violin technique. Of course, a pianist uses the pedal. Okay, I'll leave you to your own devices now.
Okay.
Well, I'm glad that you had a devilishly good time. We'll hear now three pianists in succession. I'll just talk about briefly, introduce the pieces, and then they'll play and listen to each other. The first two pieces are by Janáček. He's the foremost Czech composer after Dvořák. And these are autographical pieces, like scenes from childhood. And they're called From an Overgrown Path. It's really an overgrown path of memories. And these are two pieces from a set. They're both about evening. And the first is Evening at Dusk, and conjures the mood of perhaps the insects in the background and perhaps a conversation. And the second night piece, Good Night, is two lovers taking leave of each other. Then we will hear by Brahms two late pieces. These are the latest piano pieces that he wrote. And later in life, after he'd written large sonatas and sets of variations, he took what he learned and distilled them and compressed them and wrote more or less miniature piano pieces. And the first one has a very typical Brahms falling thirds. And then after the Brahms, we will hear an impromptu by Schubert, Schubert's A-flat impromptu. He never really published it, and he never really used the word impromptu. Impromptu was created, the term, by a publisher in Vienna who thought that it conjured up images of something at the inspiration of a moment. And what does it express? Well, if we go by Schubert's songs, most of them deal with love and death and sometimes the supernatural and the wanderer looking for some kind of happiness that can't be achieved. And now I'll invite the three pianists on stage to hear Janáček, Brahms, and Schubert. Thank you.
Thank you.
one, you know, if I just think of how young Schubert was when he died, early 30s, and what music he left uncreated, the same with somebody like John Keats, it just makes my heart break. We've heard one of the greatest pianist composers tonight in Franz Liszt. I think everybody would consider Rachmaninoff also the greatest pianist composer of his generation. He composed this piece after a severe depression, and he undertook therapy with the Dr. Dahl, and then this became one of the wonderful high watermarks of our piano repertoire. One of the things about Rachmaninoff, and then I think I'll let the piece speak for itself, is that the melancholy caused, or that he evokes in us, is partly because his melodies always come back to the tonic key. So I don't want to play the Rachmaninoff second, but imagine, and then it comes back, and then it comes back, always trying to escape and always coming back to home. It's a little bit like in the Chekhov play, The Cherry Orchard, where the three sisters are always talking about going to Moscow, but never do. And some of the other characteristics of Rachmaninoff is that there are lots of bells. The piece begins with a series of bells. And now I'll let you hear it.
Thank you.
invite the pianist on stage for Stars and Stripes Forever. Even though it's not July 4th, it's that's why they call it Stars and Stripes Forever. You can play it anytime. While they arranged their seating, Sousa, of course, brought to the march. He enlarged it. He perfected it as a concert piece and increased the instrumentation, and also invented the sousaphone, which is a large kind of tuba that wraps around you while you march.